May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So we decided a while ago that we might have a preaching, teaching series on the creeds. So I'm looking for my printout that I had. It was very handy. I had my notes on it. Oh, there we go. Look at that. But I didn't just want it to be a series of lectures on the creeds. My goal is to, in a sense, use the creeds, not as scripture, because that's a slightly different thing, but as a starting point for our reflection on how that might impact and how God is speaking to us. Because I do believe that God is capable of speaking to us through more than just the printed words in the Bible. I believe God is able to speak to us in many forms. So, the creeds. The plan, roughly, is that we will sort of have an introduction to them, that's today, and then we'll kind of go through them in sections over the next little while, looking at some of the conversations and the questions that they're answering. Because that's a really important concept in the creeds, is when they were written. And they were written, well, the one we're looking at today, primarily written in year 325, so it's pretty old, and then in 381, kind of in the form that we have it now, give or take a bit. And it's called the Nicene Creed primarily because it was written in Nicaea. And it's written at a time when, you know what they say about Christians, so you get two or three Christians together, you're going to end up in an argument, aren't you? And that's what was going on. You know, this is the fairly early years of the church. We just sort of started getting some handle on what we thought scripture was, Christian scripture. We had the canons had already been formed by this stage. And now we're just entering into that lovely stage where we all agree with each other for about half a second. And then there's an argument. And the creeds are responses to those arguments, and just like in Paul's letters, we have to sort of read them to then figure out what's the question that's being asked by the community, because that gives us some context. Context matters. Creeds, this is true. Scriptures, this is true. Arguments with your husband or wife, all true. Context counts. It really does. So, this one around 325. And the idea behind a creed, well, there's a couple of pictures for it. The idea is, think of, you know, sheep. And one of the ways of picturing a creed is, this is the fence that marks safety. So, inside the creeds, we are safe. Outside the creeds, wolves. Safe, wolves, and the creeds are the statements of what we believe. Believe is an important word here. And the defining point of safety. Another way to look at it, though, is this is the core central component. And it's like a spring of water. It's a place where we come for a level of certainty in our own lives, so that then we can grow and flourish. And the metaphor there is, of course, once again using sheep. You know, sheep will actually congregate around water. So this is a place where we might congregate. And the idea behind them was, we will fill these things in, we will have these answers, and then we'll all agree and we will have attained unity. We'll have attained this idea that now we all are on the same page so that we can work together. It's not just, the goal was not getting everyone on the same page. The goal was if we've got everyone on the same page, then we can travel together. So, in the Nicene, so that's sort of the idea. Paraphrasing a lot here. The Nicene Creed is the primary set of questions is around what we would now call the Arian heresy or the Arian controversy. It doesn't have anything to do with the Arian race, kind of the Germany things. It's to do with a man called Arius. And he is arguing that when we're looking at the person of Jesus, we are looking at essentially what we would now describe kind of in the Greek system as a demigod. Part God, part man. Clearly distinguished from the true divinity of the Father. So, you remember the story of Hercules, you know, whose dad is Zeus, because Zeus got around a bit, got him into a lot of trouble with his wife, and I can't remember Hercules' mother's name off the top of my head, but a demigod, somewhere between human and divine, but not fully either, in a sense. So that's Arius's position. And his position comes from a philosophy that says, clearly in Scripture we have Jesus growing. We have him learning, we have him responding to things. And when we talk about God, we want to talk about an eternalness in the very nature of God. And a thing that changes can't also be eternal, says Arius. And if that's the case, Jesus changes, doesn't have that quality of eternalness about him, can't be fully God. So there's an argument that, you know, there's an argument that starts. And the argument comes down to that might be the case, but, if Jesus isn't God, then the work that Jesus does is not the work intrinsically of God. It's a, think of it as somebody who sells a fake artwork. You know, they copy out Salvador Dali. He's a pretty cool artist. They copy one of his, or they photocopy it and they sell it as an original. It's a fake. You know? And so the argument is, but so either God is faking it in the work of Jesus Christ, or Jesus is faking it, or in Jesus we truly have God. And so it becomes very much bound into Trinitarian theology. The final part that's added on later on in 381 is also bound in Trinitarian theology and work of the Holy Spirit and those sorts of things. We'll get further into that. Kind of coming back to the homily section though, the idea that, so where does this speak to us? Where does this speak to us? It starts at the idea that the goal is that we might be all on the same page so that we might move forward. The goal, in a sense, is not the same page. And looking around the world right now, I think we could suggest that having all Christians agree enough that we might think we're all on the same page seems like it's not a nearby goal. I don't think. I think we're at a place where we have to acknowledge that there are some very substantial gaps between groups that would describe themselves as Christian. However, the purpose of the Creed was to get us all on one page so that we could work together. And I believe that goal is still a goal that we should be working towards. That is, that we might work together for the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is not a geographical place. It's not defined by borders and boundaries and walls. But is rather that space in which we respond to God as Lord. And if we can all together respond to God as Lord, then our actions might be actions that promote that which God wishes to promote: life, growth, and health. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.